All right, so let me get started with the next question. So it says a uniform rod of some mass. I think this uniform is going to be important. And let me label mass. So mass M and length, some length, 2.4 meters, is free to rotate about one end. So I think this is going to be important. This is going to be my pivot point. If the rod is released from rest at an angle of 60 degrees, let me call that theta, with respect to the horizontal, what is the speed of the tip as of the rod as it passes the horizontal position? So let me draw a representation of the rod in the horizontal position. And what it's asking for is how fast is the tip moving? Let me call that, that's the symbol the question is using. All right, and so after reading through the question, I hope it's kind of intuitive to you that there's a conserved quantity here that you can apply conservation of energy to this question. You know, if it's not immediately intuitively obvious, then you, I guess the conservation law problem solving strategy, that's what I would try on basically any question where I didn't immediately know what to do. Because conservation law strategies are usually easier to apply. So in the cases when it doesn't apply, it's quicker to roll them out. So as you are considering if conservation of energy applies, what you should be thinking about is, okay, so what is the work done by non-conservative force? And you should be able to convince yourself that whatever the forces are at this pivot point, as long as it's frictionless, there's no work being done. Any normal forces at this pivot point is not doing any work because there's no displacement in that sense. Friction, because there's a sliding between surfaces, there can be work done. Okay, and the other only other force is gravity, and gravity is a conservative force. It'll get accounted for in potential energy. So after you work through that, then you say, all right, I'm going to use conservation of energy approach to solve this question. And so we don't give you a set like a set of steps as we do with the standard strategy, but these are the steps I like to go through when I apply conservation laws. The first is verifying conserved quantity. And it, you know, it takes some experience and intuition to kind of identify conserved quantity. But once I have a quantity that I think is conserved, then I go through rules like these to verify that they're conserved. And once you convince yourself that they're conserved, then the second thing to do is, oh, I think first time I didn't do it this way, but once you identify conserved quantity, then really the thing you need to do is identify useful snapshots. By the way, this isn't like a standard strategy where there's an actual, you know, fixed four-step process. This is something I'm just making up, improvising as I go. But this is what I would like to do. So when I'm trying to identify useful snapshots, I look at what quantity is being sought. So I'm being asked for this quantity here. So this is going to be one of the snapshots. I need to include the moment in time when this rod is in the horizontal position. Let me call that my snapshot too. And the initial position is usually a useful snapshot to include. So let me call this snapshot one. So I identify the useful snapshot, and then the step that sets me up with the mathematical expression that I'll need is the next step, which is writing down conservation law equation. In this case, it will be one equation. So here, I already identified that energy is conserved. So I'll be writing down the expression for the total energy for snapshots one and two. and kind of schematically, the content of total energy is the sum of the potential energy plus kinetic energy. So at snapshot one, and because that's a conserved quantity, that should be equal to potential energy and kinetic energy at snapshot two. Now, as we consider potential energy at snapshot one, so I have some sense it's gonna be gravitational potential energy. So that's where you need to identify center of mass. This is one of the special properties of center of mass, in that when you are dealing with the gravitational potential energy, you can, and you are dealing with an extended body which has masses distributed throughout some, you know, more than a single point, you can simplify that setup as though all the mass is a point mass at the center of mass. It's not an approximation. You can mathematically prove the equivalence between them, but I'm not going to go through that. The useful thing for you to know is that you can treat this extended mass as a point mass at the center of mass. So this is going to be the effective height that I use for the mass. And it looks like I actually need to go through the geometry to figure out what that h will be. So the length of the rod, that h should be equal to half the length of the rod times sine theta. If you're not sure, pause this recording now and convince yourself that that's the correct expression for the height. So I'm going to need that. So let me start just writing that. So the potential energy at snapshot one is going to be mg times the height plus the kinetic energy. It's released from rest. So zero kinetic energy at snapshot one is equal to, and I guess by writing down the PE1 that way, I have implicitly defined this point as y, or that line as y equal to zero. So by the way I wrote down potential energy at snapshot one, without explicitly saying so, I made the potential energy at snapshot two zero. You need to come to face with the fact at some point. Plus, now I have kinetic energy, and this is something that's going to come up in more detail in, I think, another question. But now that we are dealing with the rigid body rotation, I want to make sure you are aware of different components or different constituents of kinetic energy. You can be dealing with the translational kinetic energy. That's what we are used to dealing with. 1/2 mass or inertia times the velocity squared. And now that the rotation is energetically significant, you might have rotational kinetic energy of 1/2 rotational inertia or moment of inertia times angular velocity squared. So there are different approaches here. And so you could break up the motion into motion of center of mass, so velocity of center of mass plus rotation around the center of mass. That's a valid choice you can make. And I think one of the questions I will show you that. But the another valid way to approach this question is to consider the whole motion as a pure rotation about a fixed point. So I can treat this as a fixed point pivot of rotation and treat this motion as a pure rotation around that pivot. So that's valid too. And that's what I'm going to do for this question here. I'm going to not consider any translational motion. I'm just considering rotational motion around the pivot point. And both the rotational inertia and angular velocity will be about the pivot point. So let me write down here, for the purpose of equation, 1/2 I omega squared. All right, it looks like I'm gonna need an expression for I, rotational inertia, I happen to have it memorized for rotation of a rod about its end point. It's going to be 1/3 mass of the rod times its length squared. And by the way, I guess it doesn't really apply this semester because of COVID-19. We have to figure out how to do your exam. That's some sort of a take-home exam. But if you were taking an in-person proctored 2-hour-long exam, a moment of inertia is one thing that you don't have to worry about memorizing. I will give you this table of rotational inertias. So, the rotation of a thin rod about an endpoint, it's, 1/3 ml squared. Great, I have it memorized, but you don't have to worry about memorizing it. It's something I'm going to give to you. So, but that's the rotational inertia I'm going to use. I need that. Let me plug in these expressions and see where I'm at. So plugging in those, I have mg L over 2 sine theta is equal to, 1/2, 1/3 ml squared omega squared. And hopefully going through this equation, you see that you have every quantity except for omega, which is good. We can solve for omega. But the challenge is, it's not asking for omega. It's asking for linear velocity of this point here. So you need something that's going to be relating angular velocity, omega, to the linear speed, v. And that relationship is something I think you have seen previously. The tangential speed, v, is equal to angular velocity times the radius of that circular thing that it's traveling. So once we find omega, we can use this expression here to calculate the numerical value of v, and r here will be just the length of the rod, which we are given here. So let me solve for omega. Let's see, masses cancel out. Great. I mean, we have mass, but it's good to know that we don't need it. One factor of L cancels out. Let me cancel 1/2. And I think I'm ready to solve for omega. So, or omega squared is equal to 3 times g sine theta divided by L. And I think that's everything. Double check the unit. G is meter per second squared. L is meter. So I have unit of 1/2 squared, which is the correct unit for omega squared, radian squared per second squared. And radian is not a real unit. So to find omega, you just have to take the square root. So that will be your omega here. And once you have omega, you can work out numerical value if you want. You can calculate calculate the linear speed v as omega times L. And you can do this just numerically, or you can do it algebraically. And I think it simplifies a little bit, but it doesn't quite simplify enough. Either way is fine.